Well, so once again, good evening to each and every one of you who have joined us today. And I would like to say welcome to each and every one of you for joining this session. Also, since most of you might have joined this session in the morning also, as I'm assuming. But if you have missed that session, don't worry. We will be starting from basics here in Python. Okay, so whatever you have learned in the C language on in the morning, you can take some concepts from there while learning this language. Or if you haven't learned, if you haven't joined that particular class, don't worry. You can learn those concepts here too, because initially some concepts are same and the rest are different. So, well, before starting, I would like to tell you a few things. That is, when you are facing any doubts or you are facing some difficulties, please post that in the chat section and please don't unmute yourself. And we will be taking up the doubts somewhere in the middle and somewhere up at the end. Also, if you have any doubt after the session, okay, so after the session gets over, you can just post that in the group, okay, and maybe you can reach some team member, okay, and you can find the team members on the club's website, reach them, ask your doubts. Maybe your doubts can be related to session. Maybe your doubts can be related to anything. Okay, suppose your career, maybe something that you are not able to understand out of the context. So please just see that you make a connection with us, because it is really important that we all are connected. Then only we can learn and grow together, right? So without wasting any time, we can move ahead. And one thing that this particular class is for each and every one of you. If you haven't registered yourself, please do register, because from next time you will be getting links on your personal email IDs if you have registered. So just make sure that you are registered once you register.
भैया एक्सक्यूज
Yes, Sareem.
भैया आई जस्ट फिल दैट फॉर्म बट आई डोंट गेट एनी काइंड ऑफ ईमेल
See you. It takes around 24 hours for confirmation email to come once your details have been verified. So don't worry, you will get the email for the payment and etc. by tonight. Okay, but now you can do the class, no worries. This is free for all. So today, first of all, what we are going to learn is basically the a basic introduction to Python, where we will be learning about the basics of Python, features of Python, some statements like conditional and others, and there's a surprise for you at the end. Well, this is a surprise that I am damn sure that no one of you will be expecting, but that's gonna be amazing. Also, I would like to introduce you to the speakers, Aradhya Bansal and me, Apoorv Goyal. So, first of all, I would like to introduce myself. So, I'm Apoorv Goyal, a volunteer at AME Robo Club and a second year computer engineering undergraduate. And, like I am here today to take this session because Python is one of my favorite language and I have been working on it since my first year. So, Aradhya, would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure, Apoorv, thank you. A very warm welcome to all of you. I am Aradhya Bansal and I'm social media manager at AME Robo Club. I'm also currently in second year and I'm from ECE branch. I'm doing electronics. So Python is very helpful in, even in electronics too. So I think you'll be enjoying this session a lot.
Thanks a lot, Aradhya, for this wonderful introduction of yours. And now we can move ahead and see what we have today. So, what is Python? This is a general purpose, high-level interpreted language with dynamic semantics. It also works nicely with scripted language. I know this is really intimidating, because these are some really difficult terms maybe for the one who has seen them for the first time. But let me simplify that for you. So basically, language are of different types: a low level, high level, middle level language. So Python is a high level language, and it is an interpreted language. So what that simply means is that basically your code, whatever you are writing, when it is compiled, it is converted into machine code. So you all know that at the basic fundamental level, what works is the binary, the ones and zeros. And those ones and zeros make the fundamental of the existence of a particular computer. Okay, so these code which you write in a language that you can understand is finally converted to that language. It is not like computer is understanding these language directly. They had to be used, they had to be compiled, or they had to be interpreted. So why did I use these different terms, compile and interpret it? Right, so you need a mediator, right? Either it is a compiler or it is an interpreter, which converts the language that you write, maybe in Python or C, into machine code, that is zeros and ones. So compiler and interpreter works differently. What a compiler does is, a compiler first scans your code, basically syntactically checks your code. It checks whether you have used the correct rules, you have followed all the rules while writing that particular language. And when you follow all the rules correctly, it will simply compile your code with a success, okay? And if somewhere you have made any, matlab kahi koi galti kar di hai, if you have made any particular changes in the code that is not according to the rules of that particular language, it will say, hey, this particular line is not good, okay? This particular error is occurring in this line number 17, line number 18. So if an error is occurring in multiple lines, it will tell you that these particular lines are having some error, so please resolve that. Okay, something like that. Maybe it is an error message that you have to understand, and you will get to know that with time. So this is how a compiler works. But what, like, how an interpreter works? An interpreter doesn't work like a compiler. Basically, it not scans whole of the code at once. It checks the code line by line. So suppose you have written a code of 10 lines. So first it will check line number one. Line number one, dekhi, it's okay. Then it will check line number two. Line number two is okay. Line number three is fine. Line number four, okay, there is some error. Matlab waha pe kuch likhna tha, print likhna tha, aur print f likh diya. So maybe you have written something else. So it will say, okay, this line mein error hai, to isko sahi karo. It won't tell, ho sakta hai line number six mein bhi error ho, line number seven mein bhi ho. But it won't reach there until and unless we fix this error. Okay, so pehle ye error fix kiya, then you run the code again, it will check, then it will tell you, okay, ab is line mein bhi error hai, then you run the code again. So maybe you have to run code again and again, and then debug that code. But maybe it seems like you have to do a lot of work here while working with an interpreter, because Python is an interpreted language. But you all must have heard that Python is a language that is used widely in machine learning, in artificial intelligence, and like everywhere where you have to make something, make a product, and you don't have to think about the speed. Okay. So that is why Python is preferred, though it is an interpreted language. And C and C++, these are the compiled languages. So I hope that you must have got an idea of what a compiler, what an interpreter is. Okay.
Hello. Apoorv, I think you're not audible.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay, thanks a lot. So, like what I was saying is that, why should we learn Python? Any guesses? Like you can type in the chat box. Like, why do you think you should learn Python? I have told something to you. I have told some reasons to learn Python. So any reasons from your side, please interact, because that is really important. Well, Python is one of the widely used language. True that. Okay, it has wide applications. Yes, it has numerous applications. You can't even imagine. It is the most easiest language to learn. You can say that. It differs from person to person, but yes, Python in itself has quite easier, quite a language that one can understand easily. Easy to make websites. Yes, you can use different Python frameworks. You will learn in the maybe in the upcoming sessions sometime. Okay. Now, what did Python prefer to most rather than other language? Like there are numerous examples. I'm really glad that you all know so much about this. Okay, so Exactly, you have covered each and every point. You can do machine learning, you can do web development, you can do quick prototyping. And suppose you are going in a hackathon, you have to make a product in 24 hours. So in that case, you will choose a language that is fast, that is like easier to write and understand, right? So Python is like Python holds a upper hand there. Yes, exactly. You don't have to write bulk of codes as we have many predefined libraries. Yes, libraries are a blessing when we talk about Python. So moving ahead, I found this particular answer on Quora. So basically, which language is best? C, C++, Python, or Java? So they have given, like you can say, a satiric answer, maybe a funny answer. But it is true that C++ is used where we need execution speed. A simple operating system, maybe a complex operating system, is written in C. So C, like C language, has its own benefit. C++ has its own benefit, and Python is used when you have to make some product that has to be used widely. Okay, so Python is preferred over there because it is quite easy to use, and Java is something different. Okay, so Java is like too secure while writing, and while writing a C, okay, so this is a meme, the one you are seeing on the right-hand side. If you know C or C++, you will get it easily. I will not explain the meme because memes are something that you should understand yourself. Okay. So, yeah, a lot of companies are using Python these days, from YouTube, Google, Dropbox, Raspberry Pi, Netflix, and a lot more. Okay, a lot of code that has been written is written using Python. Okay, so Python has a vast examples. Okay, so you can already search about it on Google and you will find a lot of projects available there. Okay, well, now we know, because it is important that what we are learning, we should know why we are learning that. Now we know why we are learning Python and what are the advantages. So now is the time we talk about code. We see how the code works, because talk is cheap and show me the code is something that you must have heard in earlier. So today, what we will use for coding in Python is basically a Google Colab. So Google Colab is basically a platform that is provided by Google, where we can, it is mainly used for machine learning and other purposes, where we have to use a lot of CPU resources, but we can write a simple Python code over there too. So we will see how you can use that. Okay, and we will be using that to show you the code today. First of all, I would like to share all of my screen right now. So just a second. So basically, now I will open colab.research.google. I'm writing in the chat box the link of the same. If you are on your laptops, you can simply open that. Hit enter. So here you will see a lot of things. Okay, so if you have used it earlier, you may see different notebooks. So you can simply create a new notebook here. I will create one. Notebook is where you can save your code. Okay. And here, when you create a new notebook, you can name it either, whatever you want. But the main thing is how we'll run any code. So whatever code you will be writing, you will write here in this, I will zoom it once, in this black cell. And then you will hit this run, okay, this run button, and the code will start executing. This is how you have to use this. It is too easy to use. You just have to write code and you have to hit that run button, or you can simply use shift plus enter or control plus enter for the same. And if you want to add a new cell, okay, so basically the what Colab works is, like, you can run different codes in different cells. So the code that is running in previous cell can be dependent or can be independent of the code that is running on the another cell. You will see how to use that. So for now, you can make a Colab notebook if you are using your laptop. If you are not using, you are just watching, So don't worry, just keep on watching and we will show you how to run the code. So now I would like to pass over to Aradhya and she will take you further with the class and tell you how to start with writing your very first Python code. Aradhya, on to you.
Okay, thank you, Apoor. I hope all of you have already opened the Colab notebook and are ready to write your first code. Let me just share my screen. Is the screen visible?
Yes.
Okay, great. So you all are familiar with Colab now. So let us write our first Hello World program. So in Python, it is very simple. We simply write print and use the brackets. And as of every other language, we put on the quotation mark and write whatever you want to print. The thing here is you do not need any kind of semicolon or anything else. Python has a very small syntax and it is very, very friendly with you. So let's run the code. Right. So here we have our Hello World program. Okay, moving on. Let's go to the comments. So can anyone tell me why are comments important in any code? Why do we write comments? Yes, right. That's right, Sneha. It makes the code more descriptive for better understanding of the code. Yes, you got it right. So suppose I write a code and now I want the other person to make the required changes. To how will that person know why is that code written and what is what in that code? See, in Python, we do not define a variable, the type of the variable. So how will a person know what is that particular function or that code is doing? So to define that, we write the comments in Python to define our code and for better understanding. Right, so if you want to write a single line code, we use hash here. So see, this is what I'm writing in the comment. This is a single line code. Now this is a very large comment. We try to write the comment to the point, just the necessary words. So we won't write this, just write this single line comment, right? Because we do not need to add garbage to our code. Here now, I'll print it. Let's run it. See, the comment did not appear in our output, only the print statement. Right, now let's try for the multi-line. You can hover over here and add another code. For multi-line, we'll use triple quotes. So I've written triple quotes. Now I'll write. Let's run it. See, there is some error. What's the error? We were supposed to use triple quotes. Now I mistakenly put on the four quotation marks. That's why. So here we can see this is how we will use for multi-line. Here I've added only single line. You can add more lines to it, and yet it will work the same. Right. So this is a meme that I found, and I found it really interesting. I thought I should share it with you all. Yes, Ritik, Python is case sensitive. Right, so moving on to the data types of Python. We have numeric, dictionary, Boolean, set, and sequence type. For numeric, we have three parts, integer, float, and complex number. So what are integers? The basic normal integers that we have in our mathematics. So it is defined by int, and these are whole numbers, basic any kind of whole numbers. Okay, Now that can be negative too. Whole numbers are only positive, but in integers we can have negative integers too in Python. For a float, float are the decimal numbers, numbers with decimal point, like 2.3, 4.6, 100, 0. So this number is 100, but it has 100.0 in it, so it will be considered as a decimal point or a float point in Python. And then we also have the complex numbers. Here I have not written about complex. Let's add it. The complex numbers are, here we use complex to define the complex number. Here, like this, complex, and I'll put 3, 6. Okay, let's print it. Right, so we got 3 + 6j. So that's how we define complex numbers in Python. So Python is also compatible for complex numbers. Then we have dictionaries, like a normal English dictionary, you have a word and then the definition of that word. Similarly, in Python, we have the key value pairs. Like we have a key and then the value, like we have a name and then we can define the name. And we can have multiple key value pairs in one single dictionary. We'll be talking about all of this further later on. I'm just introducing it to you. In Boolean, it gives a logical output for a statement. Either a value can be true or false. So we represent it by bool. And like, for example, 4 < 5. It is true, so it will return true. Let's try and run this. Right, so we got true because 4 > 5. So this statement is true, so we got true. And then we have sets. Sets are basically the unordered collection. So in this, like we have A and B, we define it using the curly brackets. This is unordered because we cannot indent it in here. So we cannot see what is the set value, first set value or the second set value. No, the entire set is taken as one set. Whereas in sequence type, these can be indented. We can see what do we have, the first value in the string or in the list or in tuple. String, as you must all know already, that it is the ordered sequence of characters. So here we can have anything defined in the quotation marks. And whereas list is defined in the square brackets, right? So in a list, you can have anything, an integer and a string, or a float or a complex number or anything. Let me just show you an example. Right, so let's print a string or a list. Let's define a list. Sorry, what happened here exactly? Can anyone tell me why did the list did not appear?
Or should not be in quotation mark, as it is not a character.
No, that's not right. I can use 4 as a string. We can always use any character as a string. 4 is a character. If written in quotation marks, it will be used as a string. If written without quotation marks, it will be considered as an integer. The list did not appear because I did not write the correct name here.
Yes.
Right, so now we have the list. Okay, now to clear that doubt about 4, let me move forward towards data types, right? How to check what type of data we have. So as he was saying, 4 in quotation mark. So to check what type of data we have, we just put type and then we put on the data in that. So four in quotation marks will hopefully give a string. And yes, we have string here. So you can use four as a character. Right, whereas four without string will be appeared as an integer. See. I hope your doubt is clear now.
Yes.
Okay, great. So, okay. So now up till here, does anyone have any doubt? We can take a pause and clear that. If everything is clear, I can move forward. Okay, then let's move forward. So in Python, as I told you before, we do not need to define what type of data it is, what type of variable it is. All variables are variables in Python. Like in C, you put int before an variable. In Python, we do not do that. We simply assign the value to a variable like x is equals to 13, and that would be all. See, if you will put this code in C, there will be error that you haven't defined what type of x is, but Python will already read the code and understand what is x. So here, what we'll be getting, we'll getting integer, right? So I just tried what type of x is. It's an integer. And we didn't define it. Python understood it on its own. And that is one of the qualities that of Python. And it reduces the typing part of the code. It reduces the size of the code too. Right? It is very basics. Now, moving towards the features of Python, taking the keywords. These keywords are not used as variables. Keywords are predefined and they are used in code. You cannot use them for variables. For AND, like you must have already heard about the basic AND gate in class 12. It works same. We just write AND this and this. Okay. Right, so what does AND do? Both the conditions should be satisfied in AND. If either of one of the condition is not satisfied, then the statement will not be executed. Or it will return a false value. Right, we got yay because both the statements were true. 5 is less than 6 and 6 is less than 7. Now let's just try another one. Right, here we got oh no because the one of the statement was not true. And for or, we have here or 2, like here. So for or, either of the statement is true, we'll get the output as true. See, as you can already see, 5 is less than 6. Only one statement was true, but we got the answer as yay. So these are all, we cannot take all of the keywords here. Let's take just a few. Def keyword is used to define a function. Basically, it is short form for define. So we use def to define a function mainly. Print, you are already aware of what is print. And if we'll be taking later on, except, We'll take all of these keywords later on slowly and slowly. Just get familiar with them for now. Are there any doubts? Okay, then you can keep posting your queries. Apoorv, you can take over the session now.
Thanks a lot, Aradhya, for
Abu, you're not audible.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Okay, so there's an doubt from okay, what is assert used for? So basically, assert is something that we will be covering later on while we will like we will write a longer code using functions. So I don't want to go into that particular thing right now because it is basically about the basics of the Python. Okay, but don't worry, we will be covering each and everything. And I know that you have just got to know about a lot of technical terms, a lot of things. But here now I will start simplifying that for you. Okay, so you just saw how these if, else, and each of these things work. But now let's go a little deeper and understand how these things work on the basic level and how these are defined in Python. Right. So as Aradhya already discussed, that keywords are something that are reserved words in Python. Basically, you can't use that as a variable name or any other entity name. So you can't say, let me make another code block. Okay. So suppose if I am writing 4 equals to 0 and I'm running that code. So basically this code is not actually running because that has gone into some, maybe some infinite loop. Actually, this is not the way we should write the code. Yes, this is an invalid syntax, right? Because we have used a keyword that is reserved. Basically, reserved keywords are those we cannot use as a variable name or as a function name or as a class name, as you will study further about function and classes. So these are the keywords that are used by Python for defining different kinds of things. Okay. So let's come on another token in Python. That is identifiers. So what is an identifier? As the name suggests, something that identifies other thing, right? So basically, when you are writing a variable, when you are writing the name of a variable, make sure that you follow some basic norms. What are these norms? Let me first write variable norms and zoom in my screen. Yeah. So basically, when you are writing about a variable norm, so you should remember that whenever you write a variable, you should not start with that with an integer. Suppose I am writing the name of the variable as 1, where. So this is not the correct way of defining a variable because you see declaring a variable because this is an invalid syntax. Similarly, you can't use some special character such as slash, star, basically subtraction sign, addition sign, etc. You can only use underscore or maybe A to Z, any uppercase alphabet, any lowercase alphabet, and any number that is followed by an alphabet. Okay. So if I give a variable name as var1 equals to 2, and I just print var1. So what? Just see that it has printed my variable value as 2. But if I would have done that with some mistake, then let's see what it does. So it says that it is an invalid syntax because this is not the way we write a variable name in Python. Similarly, you need to follow some best practices. Best practices are something that you come to learn over time. When you do not know, like basically when you are just starting writing the code, you can, like most of you might be using variable name as A equals to 1, Q equals to 1, B equals to 2. But when you are writing a code for some industry, maybe some at a commercial level, maybe for some company, you don't use such variable names. You have to use self-explanatory variable names. What that means is that we should use a variable name that tells automatically what it is doing, what a function is performing in this particular code. Okay, so make sure that whenever you write a code, you use the correct variable name or maybe the right practices that we will come to learn over time. And the other things are reserved classes. Classes is something that we've been covering in other classes. And the testing the validity is something that we will be studying further. So let's go ahead and see what is the other token in Python. So the other thing is literals. What are literals? I guess you all have already learned about literals while Aradhya was teaching you. See, things are pretty simple and you don't even know when you learn such something that is a basic or maybe a fundamental of Python, and you just get to know about that. So string literal simply means if I am defining a string as a string equals to suppose Python. So basically these quotes, these double quotes, or you can all might be knowing, or if you don't know, so you can define a string in single quotes also, just like this. So both of these will work pretty fine, and you can just print over that. Okay, so this is how you can use a string literal, that is a double quote or maybe a single quote. Then comes the numeric literals. What does numeric literal means? You can define a variable as integer, okay, maybe as float value, okay, maybe as some other value. Okay, so suppose I write integer val equals to 2. So this is a numeric literal. Okay, there's nothing new in that. Similarly, a boolean literal is I'm writing that bool val equals to true. So basically this is a boolean literal. And then comes collection, is about list, tuples, and sets that already Aradhya has told you about, but we won't go into that right now because that use some concepts that we have to cover first, some concepts of you can say iteration and some other things that we will first cover, and then we'll jump on to over those collection literals. And then comes the special literals that we don't have to focus about right now. But yeah, basically literals are these are simple terms that we are writing to describe a particular variable. The next token in Python is operators. Operators, I guess, that's something everyone here knows. Basically, operator is something that is performing an operation. So there are different kinds of operators: arithmetic operator, relational, assignment, logical, bitwise, membership, and identity operator. And we will be going through each and every one of that with an example of each. So first, let us see what are arithmetic operator. So arithmetic operator, these are the same operators that you use in your classes, those primary classes, basically b plus, minus, multiplication, division, and modulus sign and exponential. So I will show you that. Suppose you have to just multiply two of the terms. So you write print 2 into 3. So that's pretty easy. It will simply print 6. And if I want to raise 2 to the power of 3, 2 to the power of 3 is 8. So I can use this. This is an exponent operator, as you can see in this table. So this will print 8. And the other thing is, suppose I am dividing 4, maybe 5 by 2. Here, what one would expect is, like generally, what we would expect is that it will print 2.5, right? And yes, you are right, it will print 2.5. But suppose I just want to print the integer value. Suppose I just want to print the quotient, okay? The quotient, you know the quotient, and remainder, each and everything. So I just want to print the quotient, and I have to print only the integer value of that. So there I will use this operator, integer division, that is float division operator. So float division operator will simply print the integer value. It will not print the decimal value. So when I will run this, it will print 2. Okay, so basically 5 when 5 and 2 are performed over a floor division, then it will return 2. And simply each and every like you can say operation will return their results accordingly. So these are what we call arithmetic operators. Then next, one of the operator that I miss here is modulus operator. So modulus operator simply returns the remainder. So 5 modulo 2 will simply return 1, right? So this is all about arithmetic operator. That's pretty easy. And next we come on to relational operator. As the name suggests, okay, before moving ahead, let me take some questions if there are any. So is there any concept like public or private variables in Python? Abhishek, that is a concept of classes, and we will be taking over those in the coming classes, as I already told you. So just hold over till that. And then Python does not have any private variables with C++ or Java does. Yes. Yes. So we will be taking over that whether it is true or not, or how that works. So next is relational operator. Relational operator is something that is defining a relation between two entities. Entities can be variable name, entities can be function, entities can be classes. Okay, suppose I'm taking a variable for now. So I will say var1 equals to 10 and var2 equals to 20. So a simple relation can be that 10 is less than 20. So how I will write that in Python? I will simply check. If this is true, then it will return true. If this is false, it will return false. So it returns true because 10 is less than 20. If I write 10 greater than 20, it will return false. If I write 10 less than equals to 20, it will return true because 10 is less than 20. Okay. So this is the relation operator that defines a relation between two of the variables. Okay. Suppose I want to check whether two variables are equal or not. So I will simply use double equals to operator and hit enter. Then it will return false because 10 is not equal to 2, is not equal to 20. And if I want to check whether two values are not equal, so this not equal sign, basically this explanation mark with equals to is collectively known as the not equal to operator. Okay, not equal to operator will simply here return true because 10 is not equal to 20. So this is pretty simple that you know how relational operator works, and these define the relation between two entities. So now we can move ahead on the assignment operator. Assignment operator, as the name suggests, that you are assigning a value. Okay, so here they have taken a particular example that x equals to 3, y equals to 2, z equals to 5. So I will use a pen here to describe that properly. Yes, okay. So you can see that first of all, they use the equals to operator. That means that equals to x plus 5, x plus y. Okay, and this is an assignment operator. Basically, it is assigning a value. And then they are using a plus equals to sign. So what this plus equals to sign means? Suppose, let us see, a is equals to, let us say x is equals to 3. Let us take the same example, y equals to 2. Now suppose I want to increase value of x by 2. Okay, that is 3 plus 2 equals to 5. I want to keep the value of x as 5. So what generally we do is x equals to x plus 2, right? And when I will print x, it should return 5. Yes, but I can do it in a shorter way using assignment operator. So what I will do, I will use plus equals to. So what this addition assignment operator does is it will perform the same function that x equals to x plus 2 is performing. So when I will run this, it will print 5. So this is the this is how the addition assignment operator works, and similarly the subtraction assignment operator works. Similarly, the multiplication assignment operator works. Suppose I want to multiply x by 2, so it should return 4. So I will use x into equals to 2. So that will return 6, okay, x equals to 3. And then we have a division assignment operator, modulo assignment operator. exponential assignment operator, and flow division. So basically, don't have to again and again assign the value of same variable and writing that variable twice. You can write that variable once in a single line and use these assignment operators for performing a particular operation, okay, on the same variable. To make sure that you are performing the operation on the same variable. You can't perform these operation on different variables, or like you can't do like this x, y into equals to something. Okay. Well, coming on to the next operator, we have bitwise operator. So bitwise operator is something that has to do with the binaries, okay, with the binary representation of a particular variable. So if a variable is represented as a binary in the machine code, okay, it is represented as a binary. So we play with those binary numbers behind the scenes using these bitwise operator. So suppose if you have read about the logic gates in your classes, then just compare it with those logic gates and you will realize how things are working. So if I'm using a bitwise AND operator, suppose I'm using print 2 and 3. So according to the bitwise AND operator, it should return me 2. Like why? Okay, so let us see. That is, 2 is represented as in binary, it is represented as 1, 0, right? And 3 is represented as 1, 1. So when you add both of them, okay, basically you are performing an AND operation. So what you get in return is a new, new value. Okay, that value can be the same as used in the operation, or maybe some new one, basically how the operation is being performed on binaries, and you get the result alongside. So there are different types of bitwise operator: bitwise AND, bitwise OR, bitwise OR, NOT, right shift, left shift. So AND, OR, OR, NOT are the same that you have studied in your logic gates, and they work similarly. 1 and 0 gives 0, 1 and 1 gives 1. So similarly, 1 or 0 gives 0, and 0 or 1 gives 1. So this is how things work in the bitwise operator. And what does right shift and left shift means? So basically, suppose a number is being represented as 00101 in the binary. Okay. And you have to get, you have to shift this number by one place. Okay, so suppose shifting this number by one place towards the right will simply do this. Let me see how can I tell you. Okay. Yes. So basically, if I want to shift this by one bit towards the right, what will be the result I am expecting? So basically, the result I am expecting is 00010. Basically, this one will vanish from here. This one will vanish from here. And instead of that, a zero will enter at the far end. Okay. So this is how a right shift works. Similarly, if you use a left shift operator, it will simply push all the bits towards the left and add a new bit, new zero bit at the right end. Okay. So don't worry if you're not getting exactly how these things are working, because if you will be getting to know that when you start solving some questions, or you start writing code yourself, okay? Because things change when something is being told to you and when you are doing that hands-on yourself. So now comes the membership operator. Membership operator, it basically checks whether something is in something or it is not in something. So what that means? Basically, this is mostly used in list, arrays, tuples, or basically all the objects that are iterative. Okay, so we haven't discussed list tuples yet. We have just given a basic introduction to that, so I won't go into that. But just imagine that you have a list of numbers. Okay, if you are not getting how this code is working, don't worry. Okay, so just focus on what I'm telling you. Suppose you have a list of number 1, 2, 3, 4, and you have to check whether 2 is there in the list of number or not. So instead of checking one by one, first of all, I what a brute force approach is. Brute force approach is something that is a knife approach. So, एक नाइव अप्रोच क्या होगी कि भाई मैं पहले जीरो मैं सबसे पहले देखूंगा कि वन है इसमें या नहीं, फिर टू वन के बाद अगला नंबर कौन सा है, अगर ये टू है तो मतलब मेरा आंसर सही है, अगर नहीं है तो मैं अगला नंबर चेक करूंगा. सो दिस इज हाउ आई कीप ऑन चेकिंग वन नंबर वन आफ्टर द अदर, एंड वंस आई फाइंड द नंबर व्हाट आई वांट इट विल रिटर्न ट्रू, इफ आई डोंट फाइंड दैट नंबर इट विल रिटर्न फॉल्स. सो इफ आई यूज टू इन लिस्ट ऑफ नम, सो लेट अस सी. That returns true. Basically, 2 is there in the list. In the list. And if I check 5, basically that is not in the list. It should return false. Yes, it returns false. Basically, 5 is not in the list. So this is how things work when you are using a membership operator. And if you want to do it other way, 5 not in, basically not in list. So this is true. 5 is not in our list of numbers. As simple as that. So this is how membership operator works. Okay, so a membership operator is basically checking whether a particular variable or maybe a particular integer string is present in a list of that particular entity or not. Then comes the identity operator, and as the name suggests, it checks whether the identity is true or not. Very simple example can be, suppose x is equals to 2, y equals to 2. Okay, and I have to check whether x is y. So it says true because the value of both of them is true, is same. Okay, and suppose I use 5 and return false because x is not same as y. So this is how you use a identity operator in Python. I guess you might have understood it. I don't need to tell more about it. And if you have any doubt, you can keep posting in the chat box. I will just take up those doubts after telling you about this logical operator. Like, why should I tell you about this logical operator? Because logical operator is something that makes a work too easy. But before coming on that, I will tell you conditional statement because that has to do something with conditional statement. So what are the conditional statements? So condition means that you are putting some condition in your code. Condition is like, suppose you are meeting a friend of yours and you both are solving a particular question, or maybe you are discussing something, maybe about politics or maybe about some game or ICC tournament. So what you discuss is that, okay, so he says that this particular thing can be true if this particular condition is true. So he says that if the weather will be okay today, so India will win. Or if the weather is not okay today, so there are less chances of India to win. What are these? These are simple conditions that you are telling on the basis of a particular, you can say, basically you are giving a result on the basis of a particular condition. So what you said is that if weather is okay, then India will win. If weather is not okay, India may win. Matlab chances kam ho sakte hain. So let us take the same example. Okay, so we say India wins. Okay, so let us take a variable. Okay, let us take a variable, India wins, and set it to true. And let us take another variable. Basically, we will take weather equals weather good equals to true, and another variable weather bad equals to true. So basically we have taken two variables that will tell whether today's weather is good or bad. So suppose I have to write a condition. Okay, so what I will do, I write if weather good. Okay, so I can also write weather equal good equal equals to true, or I can simply write if weather good. Both will work as work similarly. Because if this condition is true, your code will get into this if condition and it will execute. So let us see how. I will print India wins. Then I tell else if weather bad. So India loses, or what I will say, India may win. Okay. Now let us first set one to true and other to false. Suppose weather is good and not bad today. Okay. So obviously, if weather is good, bad is obviously false. So if weather is good, then I will simply it will simply print India wins. Okay. Oh, sorry. It uses elif here. If elif. So basically, I told him that weather is good, so India will win. So it prints India wins. If I write here that weather is not good today, I set it to false. Weather is bad today, I set it to true. Then it should print India may win. So what is happening is the control is changing. First of all, the condition which is true is holding the control, and condition which is not true is losing the control. So if condition and if else if condition and else work here similarly, that is, if your condition is true, then it will go inside this if condition and do whatever is written here. Okay. If this condition is not true, if this if condition is not true, it will go in elif condition if you have provided any, and check whether this condition is true or not. If this is also not true, in that case we can also define another condition, that is else. Else condition वो condition है जो कि हर हर condition में, मतलब हर scenario में आपको एक result देगी. Suppose आपका if condition भी false है and आपकी else if condition भी false है. So let us take an example where both these variables are false. Okay, we don't know whether weather is good or weather is bad. Okay, weather अच्छा भी नहीं है, बुरा भी नहीं है, moderate है. Okay, so in that case we print India have high chances to win. Now we will see how this code works. So here I hit and see. Here print is prints India have high chances to win. Why? Just because I have told it that India, because weather is not good, it is set to false. Weather is not bad, it is set to false. So it will enter else case and it will print India have high chances to win. So this is how these if, elif and else condition work, and this is how you can take over control. मतलब आप control ले सकते हैं based on a condition. कि अगर ये condition true है तो मुझे यहाँ control चाहिए, if ये condition true है तो मुझे यहाँ control चाहिए. Similarly, this can be used with different variable, like as Aradhya told here. I will just scroll up and show you the code again. So yeah, right here. Like here you check whether 5 is less than 6 or 8 is less than 7. What is happening here is the OR operator works this way, that if this condition is true, अगर एक कंडीशन भी ट्रू है तो इट विल गो इनसाइड द इफ कंडीशन, दिस इफ. ओके, इफ स्टेटमेंट. इफ इफ एटलीस्ट वन ऑफ द कंडीशन इज ट्रू, आइदर दिस और दिस, एंड इफ आई एम यूजिंग एंड, इन दैट केस आई एम सेइंग दैट बोथ दिस कंडीशन शुड बी ट्रू इन ऑर्डर टू रन दिस इफ स्टेटमेंट. दिस इज हाउ यू कैन डिफाइन मल्टीपल कंडीशन इन अ सिंगल इफ एल्स स्टेटमेंट एंड जस्ट change the control of each and everything, and this is how the logical operator works, and not operator. So I leave over to you, like you will like it can be a homework, and it is your homework basically, where you have to see how you can use if else condition in different forms. There are numerous forms and we can't cover each and every one of them here. So I would like you all to just see that yourself and how you are just using different if else conditions. So see, now we have talked about conditional statements. Like we're moving towards the surprise. Before entering to the surprise, I would like to tell you a really simple thing that happens with most of the developers. As you can see in this particular meme, I know that you know that we both don't know how the code works. So that shouldn't happen with you, okay? Always try to write your code in such a way that others can understand it. Suppose you are writing your code and tomorrow you are showing your friend that see, this is my code. So he should get an idea. You should use comments. You should use best practices while writing the variable names. You should use each and every possible way to make that code readable so that your friend understands whether how this code is working, and he shouldn't have to ask you. Maybe sometime you're showing this code to someone who is not your friend, maybe some a stranger. That will happen with you in your coming years. So there you have to make, you have to put this in your daily practice. Okay, you have to put this in your daily practice that you are using the best practices while writing any code. So Aradhya, what do you think?
Just before we proceed further with the surprise, I think we should also introduce the input statements, like how to take input from the user, right?
Okay, definitely.
Yes. Let me just share my screen, or should are you doing that?
Okay, I will do that. No worries.
Okay.
So whenever you want to take an input from the user, basically, obviously, every time you are not giving the values statically. Okay, user wants to give his own value. So taking input of a value is like that. You write, suppose my variable name is var equals to input, and let us print this variable, print var. So now when I will hit enter, it will first ask me. So suppose I write Python class. So basically this is a string. By default, the input is in the form of a string. Okay. If you want to take input in the form of a integer, then what you have to do, like you have to simply write int, int. And in the bracket, you have to write input. So what it will do, like suppose I will use type of operator to check that. Okay. So type operator of var. So now we will check whether the input we have taken is integer or not. So suppose I take input 54. So it says that it is an integer. And suppose I remove this integer. And now I take the values as 54. It will say that this value is a string. Okay. So this is the difference when you want to take an integer input, when you want to take a float input. Similarly, you can take a float input, right? Suppose I take a float input and I write 8.69. This will return float. And suppose I also want to write a message. I want to write enter a float value here. So you can simply use quotation marks, and under that you can write your message and hit control enter or control plus. So now I will write 9.87 and it should print the type of the variable. So this is how you use Python to take input, and you can also print any variable along with the string. So suppose I print, this is the entered value. So this is known as string concatenation. We'll be telling you about that later on, like precisely how this works. So I will just remove this float. Okay, and enter a value here. So let us enter my name here, or maybe someone else's name if you want to. So suppose I enter Apoor. So that will print, this is the entered value, Apoor. There's a space here. Yes, so this is how you can take input from the user in Python. And I guess it is done, or something has to be done, Aradhya.
Okay, I missed that part. Have you introduced indentation?
Well, not yet.
That's
okay,
that's
so important. If indentation is something, yes, that's important. Basically, I was waiting for a meme. I couldn't find one.
Okay.
To tell that to you. So indentation is something that is yes. So indentation is something that you have to just keep in mind. Like you have to use a semicolon at the end of each statement in C or C++. Similarly, you have to use indentation in Python to make your code at least run. Okay. So indentation is something. See, if you have noticed, why did I left some space here while writing my if statement? Why haven't I written it like this? Let us see. Let us just run it and see how it works. So let me zoom out and then I will run this and see if it works. So it will give me an error, indentation error. Indentation is basically a space of four tabs, basically a tab of four spaces, sorry, that has to be given in Python. It is a syntax in Python that whenever you are writing any statement, suppose a for loop or a while loop or a if statement, you have to use indentation. You will be more clear about that when you write if statement, for loop, while loop, maybe functions, classes, etc. So when you use these particular things, you will get to know how to use indentation. Basically, whenever you are using Google Colab or some other particular software, basically IDE, there you will come to know that you don't have to use, you don't have to put spaces by yourself. Okay, it automatically put that space itself. Okay, so you don't have to use indentation by yourself. But do remember that indentation is a necessary part. It is a syntax of Python. Okay, so just like I told you that C++ you use semicolon, so in Python you use indentation. Well, this another term that I just used was IDE, so Integrated Development Environment. I won't go deep into that right now, but it is simply a development environment where you run the Python code. We haven't set up that in the local PC yet. So because that would have taken a lot of time, you can install Python by your own. Or if you are facing any issue, you can just reach to us and tell us. And you can use PyCharm, maybe VS Code. These are some of the software, basically some of the IDEs that you can use for for writing any code. Okay, so PyCharm is basically a JetBrains software and JetBrains IDE that is used to write Python codes. Okay, so it is quite interactive UI. It has quite an interactive UI. I will just show you a glimpse of that. Maybe I will share my screen again for that. Just a second. So here you can see, this is how this PyCharm looks. Okay, so I won't show you how this works and all. You can just go and see how this works and you will get to know. Now, since we are moving towards the end, now is the time to reveal the surprise. What say, Aradhya?
Yeah, let's do that. So
yes,
do you
definitely.
Guys have any guesses? What kind of surprise would that be?
Any guesses? Just wild guesses. Anyone? Well, I have already revealed that. Sorry.
offline classes, unfortunately, no. Yeah, the quiz, right?
Yes. Now is the time for free chocolates to everyone. I wish we were going to college. Shit. Okay. So, yes. Now it's time for a quiz, and this quiz will be at an interactive one. Okay, so for that, I would like you all to just see my screen for a while. Let me open that quiz for you. So just give me 1 minute, that will be open soon. So, does anyone know about Kahoot? Has anyone heard about that? Maybe sometime before. If not, it's like, okay. I will just share my screen and you will get to know about that. Also, if you have any doubts, please keep on posting that in the chat box. Yes, Maz, you have. Pretty good. Yes, I know that you had an experience while giving a quiz. Basically, we hosted a quiz together, I and Mars. So let me share this now. So I guess everyone can see my screen.
Yeah.
Just. So am I audible?
Yes,
Anyone
Apoorv, you're
confirm?
audible. Yes.
Okay, so it's taking a little time, maybe due to some network issue. So now I'm sharing the screen. So everyone, if you have a mobile or if you have a laptop, you can open a tab. If you don't have a laptop right now, you can open that website in your mobile. So just type in kahoot.in in your browser. So
I'll just share the link.
yes, please. Okay, so I guess everyone will be seeing a particular pin code on my screen. So I just share my screen. So when you enter kahoot.it, basically it is kahoot.it. Yeah, so just type in this particular game pin and we are waiting for you to join.
What we have to write?
Basically, you have to write your any nickname, or maybe if you write your original name, it will be pretty good because you will be revealing the winners at the end, right here itself. So better write your original names.
Think we gotta sign up before we get our original name.
Okay, so no worries, you can go ahead with a nickname if you don't have an account. Okay. Come on, join fast.
What is
Yes.
game pin?
I have sent that in the chat. 607312.
I guess everyone can hear the music.
Yeah, cool.
That's great. Okay, so please join fast. We will start in just a minute. So if you haven't joined, you can join. There are a lot of people here. Wow. Just wonder how such fabulous nickname can be generated by Kahoot website.
Another wonder of Python.
Yes, exactly. God level. Nice. Well, 30 people have joined. I guess at least 10 to 12 are left to join too. So please join in fast. Wow, that is going to be super exciting.
Okay, till then we can introduce them about the quiz, how it
Yes.
will occur.
So, would you like to do that, Aradhya?
Yeah, sure. So, as soon as we'll start the quiz, a question will appear in front of you, and you'll have four options, just like a normal quiz. Click on the right option. The thing is, here you'll have a time limit for every question, and that will vary given the easiness of the question. If the question is very easy, maybe the time limit would be 5 seconds. Just be quick. And at the end, we'll also be announcing the winners of the quiz. So please participate, do participate in that. I think quizzes are the best way to learn.
Exactly, Aradhya. Pretty right. And also, if that, see, there are different types of questions. So maybe a question will be of multiple choice or single choice or some other type. So you will come to know as soon as the question appears on the screen. So you just have to answer that accordingly. Some questions have more points, some questions have equal points. So now I'm locking the room if everyone has joined.
Oh, just a minute. Not reached. Try again, Harshita, please.
Yes. Yes, Rishabh, bhai, you can participate too. Well, I would prefer that
the only the students.
Huh? Yeah, the students of the first year should give this. As we all know already, who will win at the end? Okay, you will mess up. Okay, great.
Okay, so is anyone else joining or should we start?
So I guess we can start now.
Yeah.
So I'm locking the room. Yeah.
Okay.
So the room is locked and now is the time I'm going to start. Hold your seatbelts.
Okay, 3, yes. 2, 1, go.
Yeah. So you get the very first question.
8 seconds. Okay, 21 got correct. Great. Well, that's great.
That's great. Let us see the leaderboard.
Okay.
Smart Lark, Noble Bobcat, Zenny, Zen Iguana, Elated Turtle, and Excited Lizard. Wow, on the lead.
Yeah, you have to be fast. It generates score on basis of your time.
Yes, so
the faster you are, the better the score.
What will be the output of the following code? Interesting. Okay. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Great. Uh-huh. 23. Let's see.
Ultimate. I'm really excited to see who is on the top right. Wow.
That okay, now that shuffled.
Okay, let's see who's next.
Yeah.
So double points for this. Wow. Hint in the image. So let's see who will answer that.
Correctly, quickly. Yeah.
And correctly, yes, correctly. That's important.
Okay.
Yeah, this is
five. That's a very interesting question.
Yes.
Okay.
No worries. Oh,
only
right
four
answers.
Got that correct.
Well,
let's see the leaderboard. Okay, Classy Possum remains at the top. Great.
And Speedy Stock has just joined the top three.
That's lovely audience.
With Cheerful Finch, you can also come ahead.
Yeah, practice just one question. This one is again for double points.
Mm-hmm. So basically, you have to tell the output, okay? For 15, 18. Okay. Answers are coming in such a frequent way that I can't even count. Seven correct answers.
Wow. That was a nice question. Let's see who got that. Okay, so we have four new winners.
Yes, so Excited Lizard has just brought Classy Possum. Oh.
Okay, the scores are very close. You can get it right, guys. Come on.
And this is the fifth question. I guess each and everyone can answer that.
Yeah. Great.
That was 18.
What was the confusion between input and int? Yeah, that got confused, now. Which one to put further and later?
Yes, I'm getting it. I just told that.
Yeah. Okay. Again, four new people. Great.
Joyful finch, elated turtle, excited lizard. Come on. Sixth question. Python is an interpreted high-level language. True or false?
Come on, this is
everyone the answer.
Yes.
Well, 32.
Great, now that's good.
Whoa.
Okay. We have the same five players, yes. Now the last question now.
Multi select.
Okay, multiple answers correct and double points. Okay, 26. Okay. Let's see who's on the third. At second.
Aha, now this spotlight one.
Great.
Congratulations to the winners and the runner-ups.
We have two runner-ups.
That was wonderful. Like, everyone did a really great job. So, well, sorry. So now it's time to see. Yeah, let us see. Okay, difficult questions were three. And yeah, a lot of people have done. Okay, 22% correct, 15% correct, 9% correct. That's great.
That was a great audience.
Yeah, definitely. So that was a great achievement. Like I would say that whoever has tried, okay, so everyone has tried their best. So no worries. In coming classes, we will be having more quizzes and you will get a lot of things there. So now, what we have in the chat box.
Yes, Rishabh, we'll have more questions in the next quiz for sure.
Definitely.
Okay, Sajid Javid says he's the topper, spotlight one.
Aha, congratulations.
And Ritik is on third. And who's on the second? Yeah, we can explain the tough questions of the quiz.
Definitely.
Sure. I'm sure.
Okay, congratulations.
Congratulations, bro.
Yeah, Apoor, can you please share the tough questions? Difficult ones.
Definitely. So just give me a second. I will open that up for you.
Yeah, sure.
So basically, this is the question that was one of the most interesting questions. And they are like, basically 0.1 plus 0.2 is not equal to 0.3. And the reason is something that has to do with the mathematics that is going behind the scenes. Okay, so if you add two float values, maybe 0.3 and 0.4, it will return 0.7. But this is the case with 0.1 and 0.2. Well, I won't go because indeed in how the changes have been done. Because because this particular question is pretty classy and there's a Medium article, or I will share that in the group maybe. And you can see that article and you will get to know that why this thing works. This is because of some binary. Some binary arithmetic that is going behind the scenes.
Okay, sure.
Well, next question. Yes.
Well, yes, I'll explain this one.
Sure.
So in this question, we are converting this number into integer. 30.998 is converted into integer. Now the integer will be 30, right? Because we'll drop the 0.998 because this is a floating number. And as I told you before, integers would be a whole number. So we'll get the 30 here. And then it will be converted into string. And then 30 into string would be a string of 30. And then 30 to float would be 30.0, right? So that is why the correct answer is 30.0.
Yes, true that.
Okay, the next last one. I think we have three questions, right?
Yes, so integer input, that was pretty easy one. This was also a pretty easy one. Python is an interpreted high level language.
Yes, yes.
And then the last one. So this particular question, basically see, assignment operator, I just told you and I showed you in the GitLab repository that equals to sign and plus equals to both are an assignment comes under the category of assignment operators, right? So one is addition assignment operator, another is assignment operator. Okay. So this is the answer of this particular question. So, well, I guess all questions, difficult questions have been covered.
Yeah, right.
Awesome. So now it's time for your queries if you have any, and we are heading towards the end of the session today, end of the class. So any queries, just post it here, and I am also sharing the GitLab repository link in the chat box, so everyone can view that, so that you have with you what we have gone through in the whole class. So check the chat box for the same. I have just shared a link. You can later on view this particular repository. This particular notebook. I'm using the word repository. Yeah.
Okay. Aram, all the registered students will be getting an mail for the next class, in which it will be having the link.
So C and Python to learn simultaneously is a good idea. Abhishek, see, it depends totally over you, because nothing is, this is not difficult to learn both of them together. Since we have less time, okay, so we have to cover each and everything simultaneously. And also, you have a span of 1 week or maybe 4 to 5 days at least, where you can go over through each of the every topic, the whichever language you prefer. Maybe if you want to work over one language or maybe two languages, you can check that. Okay, so basically here we are providing you the basics, okay, and in the further classes we will be taking it to a further level, so you can see what you are getting from it and which one you are you are preferring to go with. Okay, if you are preferring to go with both of them, definitely you can. It's not an issue. If you like one, or if you don't like another, if you are getting to understand both of them, that's up to you. Okay.
Yeah, but as said, you should focus on one thing at one time. So
exactly.
That will help you learn better. See, if you learn one language, it will be very easy for you to switch to another, because the concepts are the same, or the difference is just of syntax. So that is why my suggestion is just see where your interest is going and choose one language for the time being. In the classes, we'll be covering the basics, so you'll know which language you should go with.
And the notebook link will be shared on Google Classroom, sure. And all the recordings will be uploaded on YouTube channel of AMB Rubo Club too. So make sure that you subscribe and so that you know about all the upcoming video there. They will be uploaded there itself. Okay, so Aradhya, would you like to suggest a book for Python?
Yeah, sure. Let me just
There was a book with
Yeah, I'm
overview.
just looking for the name, the one I read.
Yes, sure. Then let's see.
Okay, so the book's name is Learning Python Itself. It's by Mark Lutz. Well, it's a very wonderful book. I'll just share the name in the chat.
Yes, Arham, you have to be like fully registered. You have to make payment once you receive the email with the payment details. Yeah, Mars, Python for Everybody. That is also a great book. You
Yes.
can just check those books and see which one you are able to. So I guess like most of the doubts have been covered. And if you have any more doubts, as I already said, you can ask in the group and feel free to reach any of the senior, okay? Any of the team member if you have any doubts. We are always there to help you.
Yeah, making your contacts is it's like a part of your college life. Since you're not going to the college, so just do that online and contact us.
Yeah. So here we end over this today, and I hope you all enjoyed this and this whole session and got like amazing takeaways.
Yeah, we'll be posting an assignment. Just solve that on Google Classroom.
Yeah. So, bye-bye everyone. Take care.
Bye.